So I'd like to introduce our speaker. It's really a pleasure to have Vijay Vazirani visiting us today. Vijay's on the faculty at Georgia Tech, where he's been for 20 plus years, but I won't divulge the number, the actual number.
It could be 80,
yeah,
right?
Yeah. Vijay's responsible for some really major results in theoretical computer science. Back in the 80s, he came up with what is, I think, still currently the best algorithm for matching in a general graph, which is an absolutely classic problem in theoretical computer science. The last decade or so, he's been a pioneer in approximation algorithms and has developed the use of the primal dual method, which has been a very powerful technique in proving approximation algorithms for NP-hard problems. And many of you may know him because he's written the definitive textbook on the topic. In recent years, Vijay's been working in computational game theory, and in particular, computing market equilibria, which is the topic of his talk today. So welcome.
Thank you. Yeah. It's really a pleasure to be here.
You've got your mic on?
Oh, yeah. And thanks to Sandy for the invitation, and to you all for coming to the talk. I'm going to talk about markets on the internet. So markets have been with us for a very, very long time, right? Ever since they looked like that. But through the ages, markets have evolved. They're a very, very important part of human activity. That's where we get everything. And at some point, for instance, the stock market was introduced and made a big difference in our lives, I guess. Positive or negative, I won't say. And with the internet, there's been a revolution in the definition of a market. And I'll justify the statement in my talk. Let me start with the following quote of Christos Papazimitriou. So he says that the internet transformed, informed, and accelerated markets while creating new, theretofore unimaginable kinds of markets, in addition to being itself, in important ways, a market. And this quote comes from a foreword that he wrote for the book on algorithmic game theory that was edited together with Noam Nissan, Tim Rafkart, and Eva Tardosh, and myself, and he wrote the foreword, the beautiful foreword. And this statement of his, which was made in 2007, had already enough evidence and has proven to be even more true over the years. And these new markets have been defined by these internet companies such as Google, Amazon, Yahoo, eBay, Uber, and so on. And these markets are very different from traditional markets. First of all, they have their own scale at which they operate, massive, huge, each one of them. And there's very easy scalability because on a computer, you can, like Facebook, which is not a market per se, but when they had half a billion users, they had only 500 employees. So, I mean, that's the scalability of these markets with computers, the computing power. They're highly innovative, nothing to do with the traditional market models, you'll see that. And because of the massive computational power available and all the nice algorithmic and game theoretic tools that we have developed over the years, there's really an opportunity here to custom design mechanisms for these markets, which is what my work has been on. Primarily. And I'm going to talk about two main markets here, the AdWords market and the cloud computing market, which are both massive, gigantic in terms of size, revenue, and impact. For instance, the AdWords market of Google alone deals with billions of auctions daily. It conducts billions of auctions daily. For what purpose, I'll come to in a moment. But this is all part of our age of new age of big data. And shouldn't come as a surprise to anybody over here, because I hear that you have started a new data science major, which is really a fabulous, very progressive step. And both of these are highly innovative, as I'll justify again in a moment. And there's much scope for improving the mechanisms. I hope I don't lose anything under that. Okay. There's no way to change that. It's okay. Maybe let's see if.
We'll see if it's a problem.
At least I'll read it out.
The other one behind you is fine.
This one's okay.
Oh, this one's okay. Sorry.
Okay, good.
Yeah, okay. Okay, so starting with the AdWords market, which is. AdWords is essentially a trademark name from Google, but similar markets are also run by Microsoft and Yahoo. They have how they run is well known, but I'll again review it. But just to mention a very important feature is that besides revolutionizing markets, these markets in particular have revolutionized advertising. So you can now project highly targeted advertisers to people. You don't have to bombard people with useless ads they don't want to see. You can send to people ads that are totally relevant to what they want. And this has been also a big boon for small advertisers who had no means for advertising in the past, typically. The corner store in a pizza store in the corner, or the maid who wants a few more houses to work in. I mean, how would they advertise? Google gives them the way. And there are millions of such people, and they all lie in the heavy tail of this advertising market. And in particular, through this means, Google has accumulated a huge amount of very, very valuable, highly sensitive data. I don't know what's going to happen with that eventually. That's a can of worms that we should never open, I hope, because there are amazing privacy issues involved, and everybody's most sensitive details are sitting out there. Here's how it all works. So some user types YAUX, maybe to understand what YAUX is all about, or to look for a pharmacy that carries YAUX, and you see ads on the site, the sponsored links. And in this case, you don't get ads from sellers of YAUX, pharmacy stores, but lawyers who want to attract people who have been hurt by YAUX, because every such client, if the case works out, is millions of dollars for the lawyer. Okay? And these ad slots, for these ad slots, they have played quite a bit of money. They have bid a lot of money, maybe $50 to $100, just to be in the following way. So once you see these ads, if you click on this, then whatever they have bid has to be paid to Google, the $50 or $100. So each time you click, you're helping out Google, okay? And making sure that Google is able to provide you with the search 24/7 for free. So I hope Google doesn't hear that.
You're hurting a lawyer in this case.
Huh?
And you're hurting a lawyer.
Hurting the lawyer, yes. So click fraud is a major a problem for Google. But they have managed to salvage their business from that. I was told by Halvarian, who's a top-notch economist, he was the dean of Berkeley, and the chair of the economics department in Berkeley, he's now working at Google. He told me that there are only 30 people, PhDs, working in the click fraud part of the business. So they have mainly managed to address this issue. Otherwise, their business would have collapsed. Click fraud is where you click and take away money from your competitor, okay? By clicking on this particular lawyer's ad, you can make him lose a lot of money. Okay, and if he's your competitor, what more do you want? Okay, so that's how it works. But these people, all of them, have bid to be here. They bid specific amounts of money, and Google has put here the highest bidder, the second highest bidder, and so on, because people generally click on the highest place and the second, and less on the second highest place, and so on. So at a first glance, this Google market is just a big, massive auction, okay, where advertisers bid for specific keywords, and you just your mechanism should be simply greedy. You display the, okay, assume for now that there's only one slot available, just for simplification. But as I said, normally you okay, so let's just say that there's only one slot available, because we are algorithms people, we'll simplify things a lot, okay? So, and we'll, so the mechanism, simple mechanism is to just display the ad of the highest bidder and charge the bidder either the bid or the second highest bid, which is called the Vickery auction. He was a Nobel laureate in economics, came up with the Vickery auction, which makes which makes people bid their true amount, okay? Because if the second highest bidder is going to bid only $10, okay, why would this first lawyer bid $100? He should just bid $10.05 and get away with it, right? But if you charge him the second highest bid of $10, then he can say $100 and not be his money will not be just taken away for no reason, right? So he can say his true amount freely, okay? So that's called a Vickery auction. So by one of these two means, either highest charged bid or highest second highest bid, that's how it should operate, okay? And that's how it was operating, this particular market, for a while. But there's a big problem with this solution, because the advertisers, when they go in and they sign up to sign up with Google to say which keywords they are interested in and what their bids are, they also declare what their daily budget is. Okay. So each advertiser displays puts a limit on how much should be spent per day. So that this lawyer, for instance, doesn't go bankrupt within one day or a few days, right? So you can say, okay, $1,000 is my limit, so he wants only 10 clicks per day or something, okay? And this is the very important consideration to take care of bids. And I'll show you by an example. By the way, if there are any questions, please interrupt me at any point. Please freely interrupt me. Okay, so here's an example to show you how important the daily budgets are. So suppose we have these two bidders, bidder one, who has bid $1 for the book ad, okay, for the book keyword, rather, and $1 for the CD keyword. So if somebody types in book, you would, and Google displays this ad, and somebody clicks on that ad, then $1 goes from this bidder to Google. So I'm not going to do Vickery auctions today, right now. Okay, you're just going to charge the bidder his true amount. Okay. So, and the second bidder has bid 99 cents for book and nothing for CD. Okay, and suppose that in a day there are 100 queries of the kind book. 100 users like us have typed in book, okay, to Google to look for books, or 100 people have typed in CDs. Okay, so suppose that we run the greedy algorithm. Okay, then the queries can come in any order, right? In a day. So suppose that the queries, the first several queries are all book type, 100 queries of the book type, and because bidder one has bid more for book, the greedy algorithm will simply assign all these queries to the first bidder, right? And his money is completely exhausted, his $100. So both these bidders have declared a daily budget of only $100. So bidder one's $100 is completely exhausted. At this point, suppose that the query CD queries start coming. Bidder one has completely used up his money. Bidder two is not interested in the CD query. So this query for CD cannot be assigned anywhere. and doesn't make any money for Google. Okay, and in this manner, all these 100 CD queries are lost, and the revenue for Google is only $100. But if Google knew beforehand that it's going to get 100 book queries followed by 100 CD queries, then the optimal allocation it would do is to assign all these 100 book queries to the second bidder and get $99 from the second bidder, and all the 100 CD queries to the first bidder and get $100 from the first bidder, and the total revenue would be $199, close to twice the other, the greedy. Okay. In fact, it's easy to show that greedy will just be forced into half the optimal revenue. Okay. But here, of course, we are assuming that Google knows beforehand which queries are coming, and that's not the case. Everything has to be done online, okay? And the big question is, how do you incorporate budgets in the online algorithm, online mechanism? You have no clue which queries are going to come later, right? And this is very important. Why? Because turns out that a large fraction of advertisers are budget constrained. They don't have unbounded budgets. Maybe there are some big advertisers for maybe General Motors or maybe some lawyers who have unbounded budgets, but most, a very large fraction of the advertisers are budget constrained for one reason or another. Maybe because they don't want to take any risks on any particular day. Also, a large number of bidders sit in the heavy tail of the budget distribution. There are tons of small bidders, and we must handle them very carefully if we want to first of all serve them, and secondly make money from them, right? So it's very important to take into consideration budgets. And the biggest requirement, not the biggest, but a very important requirement, is that the solution should be very lightweight in terms of memory and computational power, because there are billions of these ads happening, these auctions happening, and everything must be done online within milliseconds. Okay, as soon as you type book, the Google displays to you the pages that are relevant to book, and it should right away put down the advertisers who are most interested in the book query, right? So everything has to be done really, really fast, and so the whole solution should be particularly simple online with a very soft touch to it. How can you do all this? So we studied this problem. So this is Umesh Vazirani, who's at Berkeley up north. And these were my two students at the time, Aranek Mehta and Amin Saveri. Oh, they're also up north, actually. Aranek Mehta is now at Google. And Amin Saveri is a professor at Stanford. So in 2005, we studied this problem. And we first came up with a very simple framework that captures the essential features of the AdWords problem. So the intent was, once we get an algorithm for this very simplified model, we'll add bells and whistles later and try to get it into an industrial grade algorithm. Chance for questions if you have any. Okay. So here's the simplified framework. Let's say that we have n advertisers who have declared their budgets. Each advertiser provides the set of keywords he's interested in and bids for each keyword. It could be different for each keyword. Okay, and in comes a query online to Google, and Google selects one ad to display. So let's assume that there's only one place for one ad for now. And let's say that the advertiser just pays his bid rather than the second highest bid. Okay, all simplifications. Okay, and we want to make sure that we maximize Google's revenue. And as is done in online algorithms, we'll do a competitive analysis, which means that we want to compare the performance of this online algorithm with the best offline algorithm. Okay, and the offline algorithm, of course, knows everything about the future queries. So it can, in the previous example, it can get $199, which of course Google cannot, being online. But it doesn't have to be stuck at $100. Can it do better than $100? Right, that's the whole question. I already showed you that that if you just assign to the highest bidder, you can be stuck with only half the revenue, half the offline revenue. Can you improve that? Okay, and the algorithm we came up with, oops. Okay, there is a little bit of a problem with the, I brought a stick with my slides. Anyway, it's not that bad. So this up arrow means exponentiation. Normally should have been up there. So e to the power of minus 1 minus alpha. So that's the function, this f alpha over 0, 1. 0, 1 represents the fraction of the spent budget, which initially will be 0 for this particular buyer, for this bidder. And at the end of, whenever his budget is exhausted, it'll be 1. And what you're supposed to do, oops, again, this thing is okay. So what I'll just read it out so that it becomes clear. So you, for each bidder, you look not just at the bid, but this function applied to the fraction of the spent budget, which lies between 0 and 1. Take this product and assign the next query to the bidder who maximizes this product rather than just the bid. Okay? So in some sense, if he has spent very little, he gets more, this f function applied to his unspent budget will be higher, so he gets a chance over somebody who has bid more than him. Okay, somebody who has spent less will be preferred to somebody who bids more. It's a relative statement, of course. Okay, and what we showed, more issues, but still not that bad. So what we showed is that this algorithm achieves a competitive ratio of 1 minus 1 over e, assuming that the bids are much, much smaller than the budget. And that's a very reasonable assumption, because typically bidders will declare a bid of, I don't know, maybe 1,000, 10,000, and make bids of 50 cents or a dollar. So this is a very reasonable assumption. And moreover, no online algorithm, randomized or deterministic. So our algorithm is deterministic. So no online algorithm, randomized or deterministic, can do better than 1 minus 1 over e. And this 1 minus 1 over e is not a new number by any means. I think Sandy has at least one or two algorithms that achieve 1 minus 1 over e online competitive factors and are optimal, right? Yeah. So, So the next issue is, you know, okay. So the next issue really is what happens in practice, right? What happens in practice? But first, let me just make sure that the bells and whistles that I threw out to simplify the problem can be added in, and they can. So so the whole thing generalizes to the case that we have multiple ad slots, that we don't charge a bidder his bid, but the next highest bid. So the person who goes to the highest lot pays the bid of the second highest bidder. Okay, he's the highest bidder, but he pays the bid of the second highest bidder, and so on. Okay, and even if bidders have different budgets and they enter and exit at different times in the day, that's also allowed. That instead of paying. I assume that as soon as your ad is displayed, you have to pay to Google. But normally, as I stated earlier, Google makes money only if the ad is clicked on by the user, right? So we can easily adapt this to pay-per-click model, because there's something called click-through rate, which is very well established within Google by empirical means, and so on. Okay, so. Yeah, so coming to practicality, is this worst case model justified? Okay. Can't we, for instance, model queries as coming from a distribution, okay, from some probability distribution, and do much better than 1 minus 1 over e? If you think about it for a moment, there is no one probability distribution that will work, because there are bursty periods, sudden shifts, you know, there are events through the course of the day, Super Bowls happen, you know, ball games happen, there are traffic jams then when people want to see, you know, look for alternative routes, and then they might be, you know, interested in also clicking into some ads to buy clothes in the meantime or something, okay. So because of all these issues, the question is there a way to model things much better to incorporate these issues? And for this, let's put in a new kind of algorithmic requirement. Okay, so basically, the model should be such that queries are chosen from a distribution, but the distribution doesn't have to be the same throughout the day. It can change, maybe even discontinuously. Okay, you can go from one distribution to the other, but in the meantime, you go through some noisy period where all kinds of strange things are happening. Okay, how do we model all of that? And one way is that we want an algorithm that is simultaneously good in the worst case when these noisy things are happening, and excellent if queries come from a distribution, even if you do not know the distribution. So somehow, by looking at the first few queries, it can say, okay, now the distribution has changed to so and so, and I can easily adapt to this distribution and do very, very well. Do much better than 1 minus 1 over e. 1 minus 1 over e is like 65% or something like that, instead of greedy being 50%. But can you go all the way to 99%? Okay. And the answer is yes. So here's a heuristic that was proposed in our paper. So we define the effective bid of a bidder to be bid times the weight of a bidder, which the weight of a bidder is initialized to 1. And after each window of queries, let's say chosen somehow, if the advertiser has spent less than he should have, then his his weight goes up, else his weight goes down. I didn't want this to be small, to mean that his weight is going down, but okay.
Double meaning,
okay. It's a smart computer here. Okay, so that's what we do. So over a window, we see how each bidder is doing, how much money he's spending, and relative to others, if he has spent too little, his weight goes up. If he has overspent, his weight goes down. So this is and instead of the bid in the previous algorithm, we use effective bid. Okay, and our conjecture was that if queries come from a distribution, this should be 1 minus epsilon factor, so like 99%. But in the worst case, it should be at least 1 minus 1 over e, so that you are doing much better than a half. Okay. And a statement pretty close to this one was proved by Devanur and Hayes. Nikhil Devanur is a former student of mine who's now at Microsoft and works, does great work in theory, but also he works with the Bing people there to look at their ads allocation issue. And he tells me that this particular, his paper, which is a slight variant of this, though that algorithm is actually being used at Microsoft. But not only that, the bid scaling algorithm, the idea of bid scaling, not necessarily by the function that I gave, but somehow reducing the bids of people who have already spent too much money so that they last through the day. This particular idea is being used widely in the industry. I have many of my students work in this industry, so I don't know. I don't know if it's considered proprietary information or not, but they tell me that it's widely used not only for bid scaling, used not only for ad auctions, but also for display ads. you know, where publishers publish your ad whenever you publish a certain article or something. Okay. So the and all this impact was possible because our idea is very fast to implement. One operation per bid is low on memory. One number per bid. There's no extra communication needed, so it has a very light footprint. Okay. And also after this work, there was a whole slew of work, new algorithmic work. Dealing with many other models where queries arrive in a random order or are picked from a distribution, or the constraints on allocations should be submodular, or we should, Google has a lot of historical data about what kinds of queries came yesterday and day before, and how you can use those, all that information, and so on and so forth. So, question is, where did this idea come from, this whole development, where did it come from? And the point, a small plug for pure theory, that all of this has its roots in pure theory, when there were really no dollar signs attached to this problem. When we took this on, we knew it was going to be an important problem for Google and other such companies. But much before that, we were studying online bipartite matching. That should be a slightly bigger U. That's the U side of the bipartite graph. And so the U side is already known to us, let's say. And the V side comes one vertex at a time together with all its edges. So like this vertex has two edges. And you have to match off this vertex as soon as it comes to one of the unmatched neighbors, right? So let's say we match it to this, create this matched edge, and then another vertex comes on the V side. It has three neighbors, one of which is already matched, but there are two others left, so we match it to the last guy. And then one more vertex comes, and both its edges are already, endpoints are already matched, so it goes unmatched. So that's what happens online. You get two matched edges. Of course, if you did it offline, you could get three matched edges. That's, of course, would happen in an online algorithm. But how well can you do? Again, if you just greedily match to whoever you can, if you can match, match. Don't leave a vertex unmatched. Match to whoever is available, okay? Any one of the available neighbors. That'll do at least half the optimal, because any maximal matching is at least half the maximum matching you would know from your undergraduate algorithms class. But can you do better? Okay, so and so any deterministic algorithm can be seen to be stuck at a half. Okay, you can easily create an example where it does no more than a half. And in 1990, Umesh Vazirani and Karp, everybody's from the north, to the north of here, huh? So we studied this problem in 1990 and gave a 1 - 1/E factor randomized algorithm. And we showed that it's optimal, okay? And you can see that this is a simple case of the Adwords problem where all the budgets are $1, because any vertex can be matched only once, and all the bids are $0 or $1. One is the vertex has an edge to this vertex on the U side, and zero otherwise, right? So it's a highly simple case of the Adwords problem. So we already knew these, of course, knew these works in 2005. And so we knew how to model the Google problem, which came as a far more complicated problem than I have described. And there was one more very nice work in 96 due to Kalyanasundaram and Bruce, who are not north of us, but east of us. And they gave a 1 - 1/E factor algorithm for what's called the B matching problem, where each vertex on the U side can be matched B times instead of once. And here you can think of it as it has a daily budget of B dollars, B is some integer, and the bids are again 0 or 1. And you can assume that B, the budget, is much, much bigger than the bid, which is 1. And again, they give 1 minus 1 over E factor algorithm. And their algorithm is very simple. So whenever a vertex comes, or a query comes, you assign it to the bidder who has spent the least amount of money so far. Okay, because all the bids are equal. They are either 0 or 1. So among the guys who have bid 1, look at how much money they have spent so far, and assign it to the guy who has spent the least money so far. Okay. It's in keeping with the philosophy of what happened in the AdWords problem. And this is also optimal. Okay. And what our method of arriving at our solution, basically what we did was we started with, we first found a new proof for the Kalyan syndrome and Prue's setting of 0-1 bids, where they had to use, by using a new technique. So this technique was not available in 1996, but a new technique called factor revealing LP, which was discovered by us in this particular JACM paper on facility location in 2003. And then we modified, so I'll tell you a bit about factor revealing LP later. And then we modified the LP here to arbitrary bids in the interval 0-1. And this turned into a new technique called trade-off revealing family of LPs, and use the dual of these LP, this family of LPs, to get the trade-off function. The trade-off function being that f of alpha being 1 minus e to the minus 1 minus alpha. How are we doing on time? 20 minutes? Okay. So that's how we obtained this 1 minus 1 over e factor proof. Should I go to the idea behind factor revealing LP or go to the next topic? 15 minutes-ish.
Yeah.
Okay, then, okay, so maybe I can come back to this if we have time. I can easily flip back to this. Or actually, why don't I say, okay. So the idea behind factor revealing LP is that we use the power of the dual of the LP, okay? So let's say that you have a particular minimization problem where you want an integral solution, okay? You can write the LP relaxation of this problem, where you get a fractional optimal solution. And suppose that you can come up, like say, set cover, okay, just to take an easy example. You can write the dual of the LP, and it's easy to sometimes, like in the case of set cover, to get an algorithm where you get an integral solution where the integral solution is completely paid for a certain dual that you build during this algorithm. But this dual is not feasible for the dual LP. But if you scale the dual by a factor gamma, okay, divided by gamma, gamma is bigger than 1, then D over gamma is dual feasible. Okay, so you have to fit the dual, okay, into the dual program. Once you determine this minimum factor gamma, then gamma becomes the approximation ratio of your algorithm, say for set cover. That's how the log n factor for set cover comes about, which is a very classic result from, 70s, due to Lovaas and Johnson and Swadal. Okay, so there's a line lost here, which is that the approximation factor is gamma. And equivalently, what we need to do, how do we find this minimum gamma that works? Well, equivalently, we need to find the worst possible instance. So that for that instance, whatever is the amount of shrinking on the dual that you need to do, that gives you the factor of the algorithm. And for that, we write a family of LPs, one for each value of n. N could be the number of elements to be covered in the case of set cover. That encodes the problem of finding the worst instance of size n. And we want to find the supremum of the optimal solutions to these LPs. Alternatively, we could write the dual of LP for each n and find feasible solutions to these duals, a family of feasible solutions okay, and take the supremum of the objective function value of these duals. Okay. So that's the factor revealing LP, and the trade-off revealing LP has several more ideas. I can only point to the paper to look it up. Okay, we're gonna change gears now and go to the cloud computing market. And this is the huge market. And all projections are that it will completely surpass the AdWords market. And these are some of the big players who are running this market. In other words, they are renting resources on the cloud. And who are the customers? Just about anybody who has to do computing. In particular, just about any startup. Okay, not anybody who has to do computing, but just about every startup, small or big, wants to be on the cloud. I've heard it from people who run even small startups. There's a particular advantage to be able to do everything on the fly. And just look up even on your iPhone and see what's happening on your program, which is running in the cloud. Okay, and this is the growth, the projection is unbelievable growth. And the basic problem is that Amazon, let's say for instance, which runs a huge cloud computing market, has these virtual machine configurations, VM configurations. Each configuration has a certain amount of computing power and memory. And customers want to rent these VM configurations. These are the resources, okay? And the question is, what should be the mechanism by which Amazon rents its resources to the customer? Okay, there are thousands of customers, who to give what to whom at what time, right? So Amazon has something called the EC2 market, Elastic Cloud Computing Market, where they have put in different ways of renting out resources. One is on demand and one is reserved, which are both very expensive. I won't go into them. They give you lots of guarantee of when you get the resource and so on. But then they have something called the spot market, which has reasonable prices. And in the spot market, the hourly rate for each kind of resource just fluctuates with time. And customers specify a limit on the hourly spending. Okay. And whenever the rate goes below the limit, so I specify a limit, okay, saying okay, I'm happy to rent at so many dollars. If their rate goes below the limit, I'm allocated the resource, and I can keep computing. And as soon as their rate goes above my limit, I'm evicted. Maybe I'm given 1 or 2 minutes to save my data, and that's it. And when will I complete the job? No idea. Depends on when it goes down again. So it's a very primitive mechanism, clearly borrowed from some place like maybe the stock market, okay, but highly inappropriate here, because in the stock market you just buy or sell a stock. Here you want a resource for a certain amount of time, and you cannot just wait forever to see when your limit will exceed the rate. Okay, so here's a market model that we have given it this year. Two of these people are my students, Nikhil Devanur and Sadra Yazan both, and two of them were my postdocs till last year, Jugal Garg and Ruta Mehta. And here's the market model. So these customers come with a certain amount of money each that they want to spend in this market, okay? And they specify how much money they have, they specify which resources they want to rent for how much time. And of course, everybody wants the resources as soon as possible to finish their jobs, okay? And Amazon rents these resources, okay, these VM configurations over time. Let's say we divided time into unit chunks. Okay, and in each slot, it can schedule one unit of each resource. And it has many different resource types, k different resource types. I'm just throwing out all the superfluous symbols, but you can imagine all of them being in place. So given the prices of resources in each slot once Amazon has decided prices. What does each agent want? She wants an optimal bundle of resources. So, okay, so there's more trouble here. a bundle of resources that minimizes her own flow time. Flow time is, okay, would have been clearer with these symbols, but basically think of it as the average time of the allocation over all the resources that she wants. Okay? And the optimal bundle is not unique. There's going to be many optimal bundles for her, all of which minimize her flow time. And the problem is to find an equilibrium, which is prices and allocations such that supply equals demand. Okay? What do I mean by that? By that, I mean that the demand of each resource in each slot should be one unit, not more than one unit. If it is strictly less, then the price of that resource in that slot should be zero. That's what demand equal to supply means in economics. And whenever you can achieve such an equilibrium, that's good for buyers and sellers both. That's how, you know, we are supposed to run our markets, according to age-old economic theory, starting all the way from Adam Smith in 1776. Okay, so let me illustrate this notion of equilibrium by this example. Suppose we have these three agents, A, B, and C. They have $100, $100, and $50, respectively. And each wants only one unit of one resource. So there's only one resource available. Simple setting. Okay. Now suppose Amazon prices these slots at $100, $100, and $50, and assigns the first slot to A, second to B, and third to C. I claim that this is not an equilibrium assignment allocation. Okay. Why is that? Because B has also bid $100, is being charged $100, and would say, okay, give me the first slot. Okay. Being in the second slot is not minimizing her average flow time relative to the prices that have been declared, right? And here's, on the other hand, equilibrium prices and allocation. If we price these slots at 120, 80, and 50, okay, so by the way, on the other hand, C is completely happy in slot three. She cannot even ask for a small amount in slot one or two, okay, because then she will not be able to complete her full job. She has only $50. Slot C is completely taking up her money of $50. Okay, if she even asks for an epsilon amount of time here, then she will not have enough money to complete her full job of one unit, right? So here is an equilibrium assignment and prices. Price the first slot at $120, second at 80, and the third slot at 50. Okay. And give the first two slots half each to A and B. And it's easy to see that neither A nor B can demand more in the first slot, because they will not have enough money then to complete their job. Okay, or else if they want more in the first slot, then they would have to get more in the third slot, and their flow time will only get worse. Okay, and so just to tell you that equilibrium is a very intricate concept. It involves matching the prices and the allocations just right, and there's a major chicken and egg issue going on here. That always happens when you want to compute a market equilibrium. It's a non-trivial notion, and algorithms tend to be quite non-trivial for the same reason. So our algorithm is equilibrium based, and basically this is the our model is equilibrium based. So this is our model, right? That each agent should demand an optimal bundle relative to prices, and prices should be equilibrium prices. Okay, so this particular solution has the temporal aspect right central to it. The temporal aspect being the time aspect, that agents have strict temporal requirements for resources, and they would like their allocation as soon as possible. And it's equilibrium based, which, as I said, is good for both buyers and sellers. On the other hand, Amazon's spot market is completely missing the temporal aspect. And that's why it's such a primitive and in some sense, you know, not okay model for the task. Okay. And but then, because of this temporal aspect, which has not been incorporated in models for which equilibria have been found, for polynomial time algorithms have been found for equilibria, it turns out that the model, none of the techniques developed for computing equilibria is applicable to this particular model that we have. And a good way to see this is that the set of equilibrium solutions is not only non-convex, but also is a high genus surface. Okay, so there's lots of extra arrows that have appeared here, but fortunately, all I need to show you is that there are lots of holes in this surface, which makes it a high genus surface. So if the set of equilibria is convex, then you can use standard methods like convex programming and so on for flow-based algorithms to find equilibria. But here, not only is the equilibrium set non-convex, it is also a high genus surface, which is not something we have seen so far. And still, turns out, through other means, we are able to find a polynomial time algorithm and a mechanism that is incentive compatible. Okay, so how much of the algorithm should I present?
Probably we should.
We gotta wrap up.
To, yeah.
2 minutes?
Yeah, a couple minutes.
Okay, I can come back to, oh boy. How many? Okay.
We understood all of that. We followed every bit.
We got. We're
you guys are much faster than me.
Yeah.
Okay. This is also clear cut. Okay. So let me just make the go to the conclusion then, and I can go back to the algorithm for individuals or whoever wants to stay back. So basically the point is the following, that in traditional markets, there's no computational power available and very little communication power available. And so there's a little scope for a centralized solution, an algorithm that runs centrally, to either equilibrium-based or otherwise. Okay. And what these markets, traditional markets, do is they use the power of the pricing mechanism, which is a very powerful mechanism based on supply and demand. Okay. And it has done a lot of good in the free market economy and is really responsible for the huge amount of progress made in the West as compared to, say, in communism, where they didn't. They had some people who were centrally making decisions based on hardly any information, you know, pulling millions of thousands of levers every day because things are changing. But here, the pricing mechanism automatically responds to demand and supply, despite all the world events that are affecting demand and supply. And all you need to communicate to people is the prices, and they know exactly what to buy. Okay, and it has a very colorful name in the language of Adam Smith, the invisible hand of the market. And by the way, China also over the last couple of decades has made massive progress by opening up its markets and resorting to a free market economy, in part. And whatever troubles they've had is because it was not fully a free market economy. On the other hand, for markets on the internet, there's a completely new regime. Massive computational power available, lots of communication available through the computers, and so a lot of scope for adding centralized features to distributed markets. Like, you know, you can convey to a centralized computer your bids and daily budgets or your resource requirements and money, and the centralized computer can say what your who to allocate an ad to or when to schedule resources in the case of Amazon. So there's a scope for many, many innovative mechanisms and much scope for, the mechanisms that these markets are based on, that people have developed, are very innovative And so there's a lot of scope for creative algorithmic work. And I just want to leave you with this thought that this is only the beginning of a revolution, a huge revolution, because markets are huge. And every day, very often we keep seeing a new market coming up on the internet. You know, like Uber came up a few years ago, Airbnb, you know. And each one will, particularly the cloud market, is going to become very big and will need very, very sophisticated mechanisms as it becomes more complex and more users enter it. So I think there's a lot of scope for very interesting work here in the future.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Same thing in
the cloud market clearing place? No, we are not using Flow actually. What we are doing is we are resorting to some modular minimization at the end of the day. Okay, so very specific solution. I one of my first works with Christos Papadimitrou, Nikhil Devanur, and Amin Saberi used Flow to compute equilibria in Fisher's linear market model. Okay, that was in 2002. So yeah, Flow is used often.
Any questions?
You are crystal clear.
Sorry?
You are crystal clear.
Oh, okay.
All right, thank you. Let's.